Yeah, so it's
work for us. And we turn the steering fully left.
We have Lindley Pavey here, the boss of the off-road school with Simon Pavey, and we want to talk a bit more about actually encouraging women to come and do the off-road school. So when I first came, we were brought to Lindley to have a nice chat about what to expect. So can you tell us a bit about how that chat went?
I think those talks work quite well, because the point of them is to make up the gap between what men have been encouraged to do traditionally and what women are sometimes nervous of doing. It's a big step to come up here. So what we need to do is fill that gap, and that's what that talk is for. I think if you give people enough information, it fills in that little spot where they think, should I be doing this or not? And we say, yes, you should. And basically what I cover off with them is what the training covers, so that they're reassured about the type of training. We do have a number of women who come to us. They've been on a trail ride school, they put on a big adventure bike, enduro bike. They're quite tall, they're feisty. There's an expectation you already have a body of knowledge that women may not have, because they haven't been racing or training like that before. And it scares them. And we want them to be not scared, to be reassured. So with the adventure training, what we're about is making sure they understand it's very controlled training, the speed's controlled, all the lessons are very carefully ordered, so that you do one thing after the other. You're not doing a lesson out of sequence, that you're protected, because your safety is really important. You don't have fun if you don't feel safe. So part of the talk covers that aspect of it, and part of it is about managing their psychological state before training, because to us that's a very important aspect of what we're doing. If you know what to expect and you know how to manage yourself, your training will then go very smoothly. So the things that I talk through in that talk to women are about managing how they talk to themselves, how they view themselves, managing the bike, managing being on training. And as a consequence, we get a very good result from it. Women feel reassured. And a lot of the things, they work because traditionally, women aren't actually trained to step forward and manage themselves in quite the way that guys are. It is a difference in upbringing sometimes. And if you factor that in and you deal with it in some way, then you get a better training outcome. And one of the things I'm after is that better training outcome. If there is a disparity in the kind of encouragement that you had as a teenager or a little child, and you weren't encouraged to go on a bike, we need to make up that gap. Sometimes people fall into that trap of thinking this isn't girly enough or whatever, or it's only for men. We need to make sure they don't think that, because in reality our sport is for everybody.
You know, downhills is a really interesting part of the course, because it's definitely one of those things that people are nervous of, not sure what to do and how to tackle it. But for me, it's one of the most beautiful parts of the course, because it's a, you know, revelationary, really. People go from certainly nervous, scared, not sure what to do, to not only better understanding of how to go downhill, but actually better understanding of what their bike can do for them. And it's probably one of the scariest points as an instructor, because after you've given the brief, there's not much you can do other than tell people to believe in what you've told them. And but then, you know, you see the confidence level really, really step up at the downhill point, the point when people have achieved downhills. Start off with going down the hill just with engine braking, which is for sure the most daunting bit the first time you do it, because it feels like you're going far too fast. And but that's where the confidence builds, because they then realize that actually the bike can go down the hill and the bike can control the descent. Of course, you need to start off doing that on a hill that's safe to go down with just the engine braking, and that there's plenty of space and runoff if someone does make a mistake.
No brakes. Good, perfect. Just go with it. Go with it. Leave. Nice. Very nice. You think you can stop now?
The trail riding was brilliant. I'm moving the bike more to the left and to the right, and my body's the opposite way to where we're turning. That's really fun, really, really cool. Those emergency stops were really good as well. First one was really slow, the second one was skid the back a little bit, but the front was cool, and then the third one, I still put my feet down, so I fell over. But yeah, really, really good fun, yeah. Definitely, today's a good day.
He was too busy riding motorbikes to go to school.
Yeah. Mark Colton.
So when you go off-road or you come to an off-road school, what do you need to wear when you go? Now we've got Simon Pavey here. Hi Simon, how are you?
Very good, how are you?
He's going to run us through kind of what you need to bring. What's the first port of call when you come to an off-road school?
I think for us, the thing we always talk about and are most concerned about is correct footwear and having good ankle protection. You know, it's even the same if you go walking in the hills, you wear sturdy boots, and you know, off-road motorcycling is the same. We don't need to fall off to hurt our feet or ankles. They're close to the ground. You know, you go to stop and you can put your foot down a bit awkwardly and twist an ankle, that kind of thing. So proper off-road boots are super critical. And these days with the boom in the adventure bike market, there's a lot of adventure motorcycle boots out there, but if you look at them, they're really just touring boots with a nice little adventure badge on them. They haven't got that real good ankle support and sturdiness of a real off-road boot, so it's super important to make sure they are actually off-road boots, I think.
Yeah. If you don't know what an off-road boot looks like, if they're very new, what should they expect to find?
That's a good question, really, because it is difficult to sort of understand the difference till you've seen one. But definitely, when you put your feet into an off-road boot, if you were to sort of kind of try and roll off the ankle, that's a good test. You can't do that in a proper off-road boot. Most of the brands on the market, they tend to be, the real off-road boots tend to have four buckles up the side. So you have, rather than just two buckles and say Velcro, they've got that stability all the way up the boot. It's not 100% true. There's a couple of the real premium brands that have found a way to do that with less buckles, but for the most part, that's a good guideline.
Yeah, I think it's important to know, because when I was purchasing my off-road boots, it was sort of like, what do I actually need to get? So that's a really vital skill, vital thing that you need to know.
Yeah.
Other than boots, we've got hands to use the controls. What kind of gloves should people be wearing?
And with gloves, it's sort of a different story, really. We don't need protection on our hands so much as we do on the road. We're far less likely to be sliding down the tarmac and need that abrasion resistance. And also tends to be quite warm most of the time, so you don't need a thick, warm glove. We're more looking for things with dexterity, because, especially when we're first doing off-road work, we're looking to improve our use of the controls, and you can only improve the use of the controls if you've got a nice feel for them. So having thin gloves makes it easy to use the clutch and the throttle and brakes. And again, typically, if you look at a proper off-road glove, it's almost got no protection. And mountain biking gloves are the same. They're quite often the same kind of design, really.
Yeah.
But yeah, thin is the key.
Cool.
Yeah.
And then we've got trousers and jackets. What kind of gear should we be wearing?
Then we can sort of talk the opposite way around, because most adventure bike textile kit these days is pretty good. You've got the ability with all the textile kit to sort of vary your temperature, I suppose. It's always got good zips for venting, and so if you do get a bit warm, you can open some zips, and if you get a bit cold, you can do them up again. So yeah, most of the kind of textile suits out there are pretty good. You can definitely wear leather, it doesn't stop you going off road, but it's real sweaty if it's hot, and if it's rainy and cold, it's cold. So yeah, that's the great thing with the textile suits on the market these days. They give you that variety.
Save your leathers for the track, basically.
Yeah.
Then we've got helmets. What are we wearing on our heads?
With helmets, I would definitely say, stick to the kind of known brand names. It's it's the old story about 10-pound head, put a 10-pound helmet on it.
Yeah.
I think we all value our heads a bit more than that. So yeah, helmets is an area that it's worth going to the kind of brand names you've heard of, really.
Yeah.
And spending a little bit more money to get a good helmet.
The other thing that I found really interesting was this little contraption here. Now, you want to talk us through this?
Yeah.
Most people know what it is, but you know, it's useful to go through it.
Yeah, and as you know, right at the start of the school, it's the first thing we always talk about is hydration. It's super important to drink plenty of water often and early. And I think for me, that's, you know, that's true riding on road or off road. You know, we're all very lazy in this country with drinking water. We like our tea and coffee, but you know, you lose concentration very quickly if you're even a tiny bit dehydrated, and then you know, riding motorcycles is inherently dangerous. So, you know, the way to do that is to be concentrating all the time.
What do we need to wear to protect ourselves? Which parts are the most important to protect?
I think the biggest thing for me with protection is to make sure your, you know, your body protection and your knee protection is comfortable, because you won't wear it and you won't concentrate on what you're doing unless it's comfortable for you. And I think these days there's so many different products on the market. You need to try stuff on and make sure it works for you. We're all a little bit different. A lot of the adventure suits these days have built-in protection in the, you know, in the pockets in the jacket. Some people prefer to take that out and wear an actual pressure suit underneath, which is much more close fitting. You know, everyone has to find their own way a little bit with protection, I think, and you know, that's where you've got to, you know, you've got to try a bit of stuff on and find out what makes you comfortable. You know,
yeah.
We also always have knee guards. People always have knee guards, and again, there's a massive variety with that. You can start off with your basic, kind of 10 quid, stop yourself whacking your knee, knee guard, which absolutely does the job. Up to, you know, you can these days you can go to a full sort of articulated knee brace knee guard, which is £700 each leg. So, you know, and in fairness, I wear them. So, you know, you've got to again find your own way a little bit with that stuff. But you, yeah, you definitely want. Definitely want some knee protection, and the boots is everything for me.